All right. Hello, everyone. What I'm going to talk about today, I don't have slides to go along with this. I just want you to understand why I don't believe the resurrection of Jesus. So you might not agree with everything I have to say, but my purpose here is to sort of communicate to you so that you understand where I'm coming from. Now, to help you understand where I'm coming from, let me start with an analogy. If I tell you I own a car, I usually don't have to present very much evidence to prove it, because you've already observed mountains of evidence that people like me own cars, so that's not an unusual claim. But if I say I own a nuclear missile, you have just as much evidence that people like me don't own nuclear missiles, so you would all agree I would need much more evidence to convince you that I owned one of those. Now, suppose I told you I own an interstellar spacecraft. That would be an even more extraordinary claim, because there is no general knowledge supporting it at all. Not only do you have lots of very good evidence that people like me don't own interstellar spacecraft, you also have no evidence this has ever been true for anyone, unlike nuclear missiles, which you know at least some people have. Therefore, the burden of evidence I would have to bear here is truly enormous. I mean, just think what it would take for you to believe that I really did have an interstellar spacecraft, and you'll see what I mean. But there is no more evidence supporting the generalization that people like Jesus get resurrected from the dead than there is for people owning starships. Therefore, the claim that Jesus rose from the dead is an extraordinary claim. So just like a claim to own a starship, it requires extraordinary evidence. Not because it's impossible, but because it's incredible. We have no more evidence of miraculous resurrections on our planet than we have for starships on our planet. So for me, Mike's evidence wouldn't be enough, for example, to prove Jesus owned a starship, if that's, for example, what he were defending. So in this case, it isn't good enough to prove to me that Jesus really rose from the dead. Now, to begin with, even if we believe the story that the tomb of Jesus was found empty, bodies go missing all the time. And he didn't actually bring up the issue of the empty tomb. He actually admitted that there's a lot of disagreement among scholars regarding the reliability of the Gospels. I'm actually going to cover the issue of the Gospels quite a lot because I think a lot of people here find that evidence convincing. To begin with, though, even if we believe the story that the tomb of Jesus was found empty, bodies go missing all the time. But when bodies go missing, we don't assume they rose from the dead. To the contrary, we know when bodies go missing, it's usually because they were stolen or misplaced. You would have to disprove those theories before you could believe anything less likely, because those things are so much more probable. The same goes for appearances of the dead. The dead appear to people all over the world. People who see them even have conversations with them and swear it was real. But we don't conclude those dead people were resurrected. We have no confirmed scientific evidence that miraculous resurrections occur, but we do have abundant scientific evidence that hallucinations occur. Certainly most appearances of the dead and of gods and spirits and other strange things people see are hallucinations, not real visitations. And this even happens with groups. For example, the Shaker cults and the Cargo cults all claim to have had mass hallucinations of different kinds. And the same goes for amazing stories. Now, in 520 AD, an anonymous monk recorded the life of Saint Genevieve, who had died only 10 years before. In his account of her life, he describes how when she ordered a cursed tree cut down, monsters sprang from it and breathed a fatal stench on many men for 2 hours. While she was sailing, 11 ships capsized, but at her prayers, they were righted again, spontaneously. She created water and oil from nothing before astonished crowds, healed the blind and lame, and several people who stole things from her actually went blind instead. No one wrote anything to contradict or challenge these claims, and they were written very near the time of the event supposedly happened. So there's no doubt that even the most fabulous beliefs, the most fabulous stories and claims, can arise within a single generation, within a matter of years, and eclipse any contrary historical fact. That's why historians like me have to be very skeptical. Another example. Less than 50 years after the Persian Wars ended in 479 BC, Herodotus asked numerous eyewitnesses and their children about the things that happened. Just like Paul, he was actually writing a history. He actually calls it that, the same verb, but he actually is writing a history. Paul didn't do that. But he went and questioned people, questioned the witnesses, and got information from them. And from their witness, he relates without any doubt that the Temple of Delphi magically defended itself with animated armaments, lightning bolts, and collapsing cliffs. The sacred olive tree of Athens, though burned by the Persians, grew a new shoot an arm's length in a single day. And all the leading men of Athens witnessed it. A crowd of soldiers saw a horse give birth to a rabbit, and a whole camp witnessed a mass resurrection of cooked fish. An empty tomb looks quite trivial by comparison. And also the resurrection claim, similarly. If these kinds of things could be made up in only a generation, less than a generation, and remain unchallenged by anyone, so could the tale of a resurrection or any other similar miracle, especially if you're talking about a mass resurrection of cooked fish seen by a whole town. This is especially the case when we have a good reason to be suspicious. Romulus, the mythical founder of Rome, just like Jesus, was the Son of God incarnate, born of a virgin, and killed by the corrupt leaders of the city. And just like Jesus, darkness covered the earth at his death, supposedly, as we're told. And like Jesus, his body went missing also. And like Jesus, he was subsequently resurrected from the dead, appeared to the living on a road to the city to communicate his gospel, and then ascended to heaven to rule from on high. There were many other resurrected gods in ancient cults of the time, including Zalmoxis and Osiris, who each died and rose again, and who each offered salvation to believers. The resurrection cults of Romulus, Osiris, and Zalmoxis all predate Christianity by more than a century, and would have been known in the Roman Middle East where Christianity began. Now, it can't be a coincidence that Jesus is also a son of God, who also died and rose from the dead. The kind of story was clearly popular at the time. Everyone was making up versions of it. So I have to ask myself, why should I believe that Jesus' story is any different from those stories? The similarities are too suspicious for me. Now, there are only two sources of historical evidence for the Jesus story, the Gospels and the Epistles. Now, Mike hasn't actually gone into discussing the Gospels very much, or the Gospel evidence, so I might actually skip some of this. I might come back to it more if I have more to say on the point and more time. He sticks to the Epistles, so let's talk about that. Now, written long before the Gospels, many decades before the Gospels, were the Epistles. But to understand what's in them, we have to understand some facts from psychology and the anthropology of religion. Now, we've documented many people have what's called schizotypal personality. They hallucinate regularly but are fully functional. And we've documented that these people tend to congregate around holy men and in religious cults. We actually have scientific studies of this. These people see all kinds of things, gods, spirits, signs in the sky. It's natural and normal. And there are a lot of these people, not by proportion in the population, but in a large population, you'll find many of them. When we turn to Paul's epistles, we find that the earliest Christians were hallucinating on a regular basis, entering ecstatic trances and prophesying and having visions and relaying the communications of spirits and speaking in tongues. So much, in fact, that Paul had to set up rules of order to control the din, and he says outsiders would think they were lunatics if they behaved out of order. That tells me the first Christians were schizotypal, which means we should be very suspicious of anything incredible they claim to have seen, especially when it confirms their religious desires and expectations. So when Paul says Jesus suddenly appeared to these people on isolated occasions, we have every reason to expect they were hallucinating, even as groups, and I might come to that again later. Paul only mentions for himself scripture and visions as his sources. Now, Mike says that he probably got stories also from the first disciples, but we don't know what stories he got from the disciples. And Paul, when he's actually arguing for the resurrection, he never actually cites this information. When he says, I handed on to you what was handed on to me, he uses the exact same phrase in Galatians, in the letter of Galatians, Galatians 1, where he actually says, I received the gospel I received and handed on to you is the gospel I received from Jesus. And he actually says that he received it in a revelation, not from a man. And this was 3 years before he talked to the disciples. So when he's talking about stuff later on, we're not sure exactly how much of what he's talking about is what he got from the disciples versus how much he got in direct conversations with Jesus. And Paul actually reports having conversations with Jesus on a regular basis. So Paul only mentions scripture and visions as his sources, and Paul cites no other sources that anyone else had. No one else had any other sources but scripture and visions as far as Paul knows, as far as we can tell from the letters. Paul says others saw Jesus just like he did. He doesn't make any distinctions, and he says he only saw Jesus in a revelation. And he says he only saw Jesus in a vision, and most visions like that, the whole world over, are religiously inspired hallucinations, not real appearances of gods or of the dead. So just based on what the prior probability is, based on what established facts are, what's actually normal and usual, I have no reason to believe any differently for the origins of Christianity than, for example, than for any other cult that has similar claims of seeing gods or spirits of the dead. Paul doesn't tell us what exactly he and these first Christians saw. He doesn't actually go into detail. He doesn't say whether it was a bodily apparition, the same way tribal Hawaiians hallucinate meetings and conversations with recently dead relatives. He doesn't, or if it's a vision of Christ up in the clouds, like the Apostle Stephen is said to have seen. In the book of Acts, Stephen looks up in court and says, I see Jesus up in the clouds in heaven. Of course, everyone else who was around there, the Jewish Sanhedrin, didn't see what he saw. That's a hallucination. Or if it was just a startling talking light in the sky, as Paul is said to have seen. The epistles don't say. They don't give us any details. We don't know what was said. We don't know what actually was seen. We don't know what the people actually said they saw. And as I explained, And as I will explain if I have time, I don't trust what the Gospels say. I don't know if Mike will say more about the Gospels. He actually skipped right past them, really. The Gospel of Mark, for example, doesn't say what kind of visions they are, and later visions that are reported in the Gospels are actually generally very suspicious stories that I don't trust at all. Now, I believe only an ordinary explanation can easily explain why Jesus only appeared to diehard believers and then, much later, to only one of millions of outsiders across the planet, Paul. If God himself were really appearing to people and really was on a compassionate mission to reform and save the world, he could have visited Pilate, Herod, the Sanhedrin, the masses of Jerusalem, the Roman legions, even the Emperor and Senate of Rome. He could have flown to America, as actually the Mormons believe he did, and even China, preaching in all the temples and courts of Asia. In fact, being God, he could have appeared to everyone on earth. He could visit me right now, or you. He could appear right now and settle this debate. Done. If Jesus was a God and really wanted to save the world, he would have appeared and delivered his gospel personally to the whole world and would still be doing so. I would do so if I were in his position, and God can't be more compassionate than I am in that respect. It's much less probable he'd appear only to one small group of believers and only one lone outsider in one tiny place just one time 2,000 years ago and then give up. But if Christianity originated as a natural movement inspired by ordinary hallucinations, then we would expect it to arise in only one small group, in one small place and time, and especially where, as in antiquity, regular hallucinators were often respected as holy and their hallucinations believed to be divine communications. And that's exactly when and where it began. The fact that it looks much like other resurrected God cults of that very time and place, that time and place, only confirms the point. It was just another religion like them, with made-up stories started by religious fanatics stirred by visions. The ordinary explanation thus predicts all we see, whereas the extraordinary explanation doesn't. And this applies even to Paul. You might think this outsider, this persecutor of the church, is an unusual occurrence. Why would he see Jesus? Well, obviously, whatever the explanation is, it has to be a rare explanation because it only happened once. There are hundreds of persecutors of the Christians, millions of outsiders, and Jesus only appears to one of them. So obviously, whatever the cause was, it has to be something very rare. Now, we actually have established in psychology certain phenomena like this, one of which is called cognitive dissonance. Cognitive dissonance is when you start to have two beliefs that conflict with each other. And this actually creates an agitating, discomforting state. And you struggle to get out of this state by reconciling or picking one side of the contradiction or finding a way to harmonize them. If you're schizotypal, if you're prone to hallucinations, as Paul clearly was, he talks about having visions and revelations all the time, having conversations with Jesus. The way out, and we know this from scientific studies, the way out of that is to hallucinate something that resolves the contradiction. Because one thing they've studied in schizotypal personalities is that having the hallucinations actually reduces stress in their lives. They actually live better lives, more comforting lives because of it. So this is one of the strategies that would be readily apparent to someone like Paul. If he were persecuting the Christian church and started to feel guilty about it, if he saw their moral behavior and realized that they were actually in the right in terms of what the right behavior was, if he realized that he was doing wrong, if he felt that he had wronged God, if he started to be convinced by their very fervent declarations that they had seen Jesus in the sky or whatever it was that they were claiming at the time, he would have cognitive dissonance. Here he is, he's hurt and injured these people and done wrong by God, while at the same time he's feeling affinity and agreement with their morals and with their convictions. The way out is to hallucinate an experience of Jesus, so that he could see Jesus himself, experience the gospel, and become a leader and actually repent of his sins, in a sense, atone for his sins by actually doing good and spreading the word and so on. So now you might say it's improbable, but we know for a fact all of the elements of that could occur. I've not advocated anything that's actually bizarre. And they would occur rarely, of course, but then again, Paul is a rare case. He's like the only outsider that was actually converted by a direct revelation from Jesus. So the way I see it, natural explanations actually are more likely inherently and actually explain the evidence well. I don't have to come up with ad hoc hypotheses. Now, Mike said that his theory satisfies a condition of plausibility. The problem is, as he defined it, plausibility requires that you to not violate any widely accepted facts. Now, the existence of God is not a widely accepted fact. Nor is the existence of a particular god a widely accepted fact. For example, there's Allah, there's Hindu gods, there's different gods. And they're not all going to resurrect Jesus. So the question is, why should we assume that? Do we have to assume that God exists before we can conclude that Jesus rose from the dead? Now suppose you do an independent investigation, you check all the facts, you look into things, and you conclude that you're not very convinced that God exists independently of all this. If you've reached that position and then you look at the historical evidence won't be sufficiently convincing to persuade you, nor should it persuade you that Jesus rose from the dead. Now maybe if you're convinced God exists and you're convinced you know that he would raise Jesus from the dead, and perhaps you have a spiritual experience yourself of experiencing Jesus, that would be a different scenario, but that wouldn't be a historical argument. Now he tasks me with coming up with specific hypotheses that's not really necessary. All I have to do is show that there are a number of possible explanations that we can't rule out that actually do meet what we call plausibility, that do satisfy widely accepted facts regarding the science of the situation, the cultural anthropology, the religion, the culture of the time. There are many possible explanations I could go into. I'm not going to, but we could talk about different kinds of ones. I don't actually claim to know which actual explanation occurred. We know very little. We have very little reliable information about the origins of Christianity. But there aren't any facts on the table that I can't explain using accepted, acknowledged kinds of explanations that we actually do know operate in the world. There are many theories contrary to what Mike has argued, but there isn't time tonight to look at them all. I will instead present the one theory I think is most probably correct, which I only have time to summarize. Shortly after the death of Jesus, his disciples prayed, meditated, and searched the scriptures for some meaning to justify the tragedy, and some way to preserve and promote the noble program of moral reform Jesus had died for. As a result, some had prophetic dreams or visions in which Jesus appeared to them, reassuring them and telling them just what they wanted to hear, that he had been raised by God so all who attached themselves to him and his moral program would participate in his resurrection as soon as this good news was preached to all Israel. The relevant content of this belief was that Jesus had been granted a new body by God, the resurrection body promised to all the faithful, abandoning his old body to the grave like a shell or husk, to return to the dust from which it came. But the new body lived in heaven, from where Jesus would soon return on clouds of glory to give us our own new bodies at the end of days. Such, I believe, was the original belief. But the church quickly fragmented into competing sects with different agendas. And over the first century, some groups became more and more Gnostic, while others became more and more Sarcistic. Gnosticism gravitated to the view that only the soul of Jesus was exalted, while Sarcism was the opposite view, that Jesus was raised only in the flesh, in the very same body that died and was buried. I believe both views are distortions of what the original Christians believed, yet both arose at roughly the same time and pace. Just as the Gnostics developed novel legends to explain and justify their view of things, so did the Sarcists. The canonical Gospels represent the parables and legends adopted or developed to serve the Sarcist program, and that was the one and only sect to obtain total power and preserve for posterity its documents and its own version of history. That is my theory in rough outline. Now I have to explain why my theory is a better explanation of the facts than Mike's. There are 9 facts that together establish that my theory is more probably correct. Number 1. Paul contradicts the Gospels of Luke and John by describing a spiritual resurrection. This is significant because Paul's letters predate the writing of the Gospels and are the only sources recorded within 20 years of the death of Jesus. In addition, unlike the authors of the Gospels, Paul's name and identity is known to us with relative certainty, and he alone names his sources and confirms them as eyewitnesses. Therefore, what Paul says carries far more historical authority than the relatively anonymous documents written down decades later that relied on unnamed and unverified sources. Since the most relevant passage from 1 Corinthians 15 is so important, I will read an abridgment of it as I have translated from the Greek. But someone will say, "How are the dead raised, and with what kind of body do they come? You idiot, what you sow is not given life unless it dies, and what you sow, you do not sow the body that will come to be, but a naked seed, perhaps of wheat or something else. But God gives it a body, just as he pleased, and to each of the seeds he gives a body all its own. Not all flesh is the same flesh, but there is one sort of flesh for men, another flesh for cattle, another flesh for birds, and another for fish. There are also bodies in heaven and bodies on earth,
But the glory of the heavenly ones is beyond the glory of the earthly ones. There is one glory for the sun, another glory for the moon, etc. So also is the resurrection of the dead. A natural body is sown, but a spiritual body is raised. So also is it written, the first man, Adam, turned into a living life form, but the last Adam into a life-giving spirit. But the spiritual body is not first. Rather, first comes the natural body, then the spiritual body. The first man is made of dust from the earth. The second man is made of something from heaven. As is the one of dust, so also are those of dust. And as is the one in heaven, so also are those in heaven. And just as we once wore the image of the one of dust, let us also come to wear the image of the one in heaven. I say this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot receive the kingdom of God, nor does decay receive indestructibility. Look, I tell you a mystery. Not all of us will fall asleep, but we'll all be changed, in an instant, in the blink of an eye, at the last trumpet. That is what Paul wrote roughly 20 years after the death of Jesus. Note that Paul explicitly says the resurrected Jesus was a spirit, and that flesh and blood cannot enter the kingdom. In fact, earlier, Paul had even said that our resurrected body will not have a stomach and so will not eat food. And here he adds that it will be completely indestructible. That's what Paul says, and that is clearly how he understood the resurrection to be. Yet this contradicts what Luke and John say. Luke claims that Christ said, "A spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." And then he eats some fish to prove it. John claims the resurrected body of Jesus was still wounded, which cannot be if it was indestructible. So from Paul we learn that Jesus was a spirit and had no stomach and thus wouldn't eat, that his body could not be blemished, and that it did not consist of flesh or blood, but of some spiritual heavenly substance. Yet Luke and John claim Jesus did eat, did have blemishes, did consist of flesh and blood, and was not a spirit. Our earliest and most reliable record says one thing, and our later record says exactly the opposite. One of them must be wrong. And most likely, it's the later, less secure sources that have it wrong. Number two, Paul omits these very crucial claims of Luke and John. It is more probable that those claims were contrived after Paul's time than that they existed at the very origin of the church, and yet Paul had never heard of them. Since his discussion here in 1 Corinthians concerned answering questions about the nature of the resurrection body, it is hardly conceivable that Paul would fail to cite the most powerful and relevant evidence, physical eyewitness encounters revealing exactly what that body was like. Number three, Paul declares that Christ's resurrection was just like ours will be, but he describes our resurrection in terms that can only be understood as exchanging one body for another, not changing the same body into something else. Paul explicitly says, "The body that dies is not the body that will rise, but God provides its own body." Paul takes great pains to explain that there are many different bodies, especially between bodies in heaven and on earth, and that our new bodies will be spiritual bodies, composed of the same stuff of the glorious stars. Paul goes out of his way to assert that the spiritual body comes after the natural body that dies. In all this, he specifically avoids ever simply saying that the natural body will become a spiritual body. He doesn't say that. His whole discourse emphasizes difference in substance and origin. Dust belongs to the earth. Spirit belongs to heaven. It follows that the body of dust must be left behind, that this is the only way to enter the heavenly realm of the indestructible. As Paul says, we will put on our new bodies like new coats, suggesting the old coat will be left behind. In fact, in Paul's phrase, "we'll all be changed," he uses the Greek word allagesamatha, which does not mean change in the sense of changing one thing into another, but is instead the verb of mercantile exchange, of trading one thing for another. This two-body doctrine was the view held by the Essene Jews, the one sect that had the most in common with the early Christian church, and it was also held by a prominent first-century Jew, Josephus, a Pharisee who specifically explains that our current bodies are inevitably corruptible and must return to the earth from which they came. So God will give us new, better bodies and in the resurrection. Philo, another Jew and a contemporary of Paul, also held to a similar view. And Josephus and Philo often use the very same concepts and language as Paul. Thus, there is a good probability that Paul shared their view and understood the resurrection just as they did, as an exchange of an old shell of a body for a new heavenly body. This would explain one peculiar fact about the letters of Paul, why he never once mentions the empty tomb or any details of the empty tomb story. Because the tomb wasn't empty. Rather, the corpse was empty, for the spirit of Jesus had been transported into a new body in heaven, just as Josephus, Philo, and the Essenes all believed would happen, and just as Paul seems to have described. Now, later stories in the Gospels about an empty tomb and appearances are the only evidence Mike has against my theory. But my theory is based on earlier and more reliable evidence, has precedence in early Jewish thought, and already has the greater probability. It is the best and simplest explanation for what Paul both says and doesn't say. But there is more evidence that the empty tomb story is, more probably than not, a legend, which probably began as a literary symbol and not a claim to historical fact, and that the original appearances were more probably than not ordinary religious visions, later embellished to support the Sarcist dogma. So now to those facts. Number 4. Throughout history, we have found that the frequency of amazing but true stories is low, very low. Such stories are rare, while the frequency of myths, legends, and tall tales is very high. Such stories are common. It follows that the probability that any amazing story will be false is higher than the probability it will be true. That doesn't mean every amazing story is false, only that this is more likely. Nor does this mean that we can never prove an amazing story true, only that we need especially strong evidence to overcome their low probability. In contrast, my theory rests on what is already the most probable, given what we know about history in general. Number 5. There is insufficient evidence to overcome the low probability that the empty tomb story is true. Being an amazing story, it is already likely to be false. To prove it is not, we need some good evidence. But the evidence we have is not at all good. In fact, it is among the worst we can have for any historical claim. There are 5 kinds of evidence we can have in history, and the more and better evidence we have from this list, the more certain we can be that a claim is true. As an example, I will compare the claim that the tomb of Jesus was found empty with the claim that Julius Caesar crossed the Rubicon. First, the physical historical necessity of this event is exceedingly great. The history of Rome could not have proceeded as it did had Caesar not physically moved an army into Italy. He could not have captured Rome or conscripted Italian men against Pompey's forces in Greece. In contrast, the discovery of an empty tomb is not necessary. For as we have seen, the original belief may well have been that Jesus switched bodies and appeared in visions. That would be sufficient to get the religion started. Thus, an empty tomb is not necessary to explain all subsequent history, unlike Caesar's crossing of the Rubicon. Second, in Caesar's case, we have lots of direct physical evidence. We have a number of inscriptions and coins produced soon after the Republican Civil War related to the Rubicon crossing. In contrast, we have no physical evidence of any kind supporting the empty tomb. No papyri survive, and no inscriptions were commissioned by the resurrected Jesus, or by the early church, or by witnesses like Peter or Joseph of Arimathea. Third, for Caesar, we have unbiased corroboration. Even Caesar's enemies, like Cicero, reported the crossing of the Rubicon, as did other hostile or neutral observers. Whereas we have no hostile or even neutral records of an empty tomb by any non-Christian until well after the Christians started telling the story, after Paul's death, and long after any facts could be checked. Fourth, we have several critical accounts of the Rubicon crossing by known scholars of the time, Suetonius, Appian, Cassius Dio, Plutarch. And we know a lot about who they were and their scholarship. They often quote and name many different sources, showing a wide reading of witnesses and documents, and they critically examine several disputed claims. They also cite or quote texts written by witnesses and contemporaries, hostile and friendly, of the Rubicon crossing and its repercussions. In contrast, we have not even a single skilled historian mentioning the empty tomb until centuries after the fact, while of those who mention the empty tomb within the first century, none show any wide reading, never name any sources, show no sign of a skilled or critical examination of conflicting claims, have no detailed scholarship to their credit that we can test for their skill and accuracy, are essentially unknown, and have an overtly declared bias towards persuasion and conversion. Fifth, there is an eyewitness account, for we have Caesar's own word on the subject. Indeed, the book The Civil War has been a Latin classic for 2,000 years. In contrast, we have nothing written by Jesus, nor any record of the empty tomb by eyewitnesses like Peter. And we do not know for certain the name or identity of any author of any of the accounts of the empty tomb that we do have, much less the name of any of their immediate sources. It should be clear that we have many reasons to believe Caesar crossed the Rubicon, all of which are lacking in the case of the empty tomb. In fact, when we compare all 5 points, we see that in 4 of them, the empty tomb has no evidence at all, and in the one proof that it does have, it has not the best, but the very worst kind of evidence, a handful of late, biased, uncritical, unscholarly, unknown, secondhand witnesses. That's not good evidence. Even seen in the best possible light, the evidence available is simply not sufficient to establish that there really was an empty tomb. Number 6, the Gospels themselves show signs of an increasing rate of legendary development. Rise of newfangled Gospels containing false claims, including myths and clever fabrications. We should certainly expect this only grew worse after Paul's day, when our Gospels were finally written. The first Gospel, Mark, tells a simple story about women going to the tomb and finding it open, meeting a single boy in white, then running off. The whole account is probably a parable and never intended to be read as history. But in the Gospel of Matthew, which simply borrowed from Mark and added to it, the boy has become an angel descending from heaven. The women experience a massive earthquake and watch the angel descend and see it open the tomb. Guards have been added to the story, and the women run off but now get to meet Jesus on the way. Can we doubt that we are looking at extensive legendary embellishment upon what began as a much more mundane story? We can see the same trend in Luke. Mark's one boy in white has been multiplied into two men who suddenly appear in dazzling apparel. Now we hear that Peter went to check the tomb and confirmed it was empty, and Jesus appears in the flesh and invites his disciples to touch him and eats fish to prove he's real, then whooshes up into heaven before their very eyes. That again sounds like a pretty fancy embellishment of Mark's far more humble story. In John, Jesus receives an absurdly fabulous burial. Peter again goes to see for himself, but this time yet another disciple goes too. Luke's two men now become two angels, and we get the elaborate tale of the doubting Thomas putting his fingers inside the wounds on Christ's body and Jesus declaring, "Blessed are they who believe without seeing." All this certainly looks like a growing legend. Number 7. We have found that genuine supernatural encounters must be extraordinarily rare, since despite 200 years of detailed scientific investigation, we have yet to confirm a single genuine case. In contrast, across the whole spectrum of human history and culture, inspiring religious dreams and hallucinations are quite common. Indeed, they are most frequent in cultures that elevate the status of such experiences, like the ancient world. And we have numerous examples of powerful dreams and hallucinations of pagan deities. We have also established the psychological and neurophysical basis of religious hallucination. It follows that the probability any appearance of God will really be a dream or hallucination is much higher than the probability of a genuine encounter with God. That doesn't mean every such encounter is false, only that this is more likely. Nor does this mean that we can never prove such an encounter genuine, only that we need especially strong evidence to overcome its low probability. In contrast, my theory rests on what is already the most probable, given what we know about human nature, the human brain, and the history of religions and ancient culture. Number 8. Paul describes the appearances of Jesus in terms more consistent with a vision than a physical body. He places himself on the list of witnesses to the risen Christ, along with Peter, James, and everyone else. And in Paul's letter to the Galatians, he says, "I neither received the gospel from a man, nor was I taught it, except through a revelation of Jesus Christ." A revelation, he specifically says, was not an encounter with flesh and blood. And the book of Acts describes Paul's experience as a vision, just a light and a voice, commonplace features of hallucination. That our earliest and best evidence would be of this character, while the only evidence of a more physical encounter with Jesus comes much later from much less secure sources, is more probable if the original experiences were in fact like Paul's vision, and less probable if they were like what some Gospels strive to depict. Number 9. Mark and Matthew don't mention Jesus appearing in the flesh, and Luke and John share the detail that Jesus suddenly appeared and disappeared on some occasions, as one would expect of a vision, and on other occasions appeared as someone else whose face no one recognized, which was a common motif in ancient religion, the god or angel appearing in disguise to test us. In contrast, details supporting a resurrection of the flesh arise only in Luke, and then appear in John, who is not an independent source since he borrowed many unique scenes from Luke. That our only evidence for a resurrection of the flesh would be entirely traceable to only one source, which we know came later than and embellished upon a source excluding those details, is more probable if it's a late fabrication and less probable if it was part of the original tradition. So those are the 9 facts that support my theory more than Mike's. There's a lot more, but I've outlined the main reasons for believing as I do. That we would have those facts rather than others is more probable if my theory is true and less probable if Mike's theory is true. So the theory that visions inspired a belief, that Jesus had been transported into the new heavenly body of the promised resurrection fits all nine facts better than any other theory. Now, obviously, we can construct some elaborate hypothesis to explain away all this evidence, but my explanation will still remain the simplest and thus the most probable, the one most loyal to what Paul himself says, and the one most consistent with known probabilities and all the actual facts of history. Thank you.
Hi, folks. This is Jason. We're looking at the minimal facts approach of the resurrection, and I'm going to be sharing with you the main arguments for the minimal fact approach, and I hope this is going to be a blessing to you. So let's come before the Lord. Lord, we thank you for this day and for your love and your grace. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor, and we thank you for all your blessings and all your care and all your grace. And so, God, we praise you today. We worship you. We give you the glory and we give you the honor. And we acknowledge that you are our God, and we give you the praise and the glory today. So, Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love, and we pray that you be with us today in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. We'll look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And we read the first 10 verses. Now let me remind you, dear brothers and sisters, of the good news I preached to you before. You welcomed it then and still do now, for your faith is built on this wonderful message, and it is this good if you firmly believe it, unless of course you believe something that was never true in the first place. I passed on to you what was most important and what had also been passed on to me, that Christ died for our sins just as the scripture says. He was buried, he was raised from the dead on the third day as the scripture said. He was seen by Peter and then by the 12 apostles, and that he was seen by more than 500 of the followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died by now. Then he was seen by James and later by all the apostles. Last of all, I saw him, too long after the others, as though I had been born at the wrong time, for I am the least of all the apostles. And last of all, I saw him too, after the others, as though I'd been born out of the wrong time, for I am the least of all the apostles, and I am not worthy to be called an apostle after the way of God. But whatever I am now, it is all because God poured out his special favor on me. So that's the passage that we're going to be looking at. In the defense of the resurrection, we have to ask, one of the first important things that we have to ask is, can we use the documents of the New Testament as an argument concerning the resurrection of Christ? Now, it's important to realize that we can use the New Testament. You don't have to believe the Bible is the Word of God to believe that the New Testament can be a source of historical information. And so you will find that historians, even secular historians, will look at various texts of the Bible in the New Testament. Critics will grant you a certain number of Paul's epistles as genuine Paul. Critics will grant you that there are aspects of the Gospels that they regard as historically accurate. Now, they might not agree with all the Gospels, they might not agree with the entirety of the Gospels, But the point is this, is that historians do use the New Testament as part of their historical inquiry. Now, what we need to do in the defense of the Christian faith concerning the resurrection is have a hypothesis, have an idea of as to what we are stating. And that hypothesis needs to explain the data that we're investigating. As we have a, and we see whether there is data that confirms or disproves it. From a historical point of view, what we're trying to do is when we've had the hypothesis, when we check it, we see if after we've checked it, whether again the facts substantiate what idea we have. So first of all, we look at the evidence that is in the topic. We look at the evidence about the resurrection. And then we say, well, what would be the best explanation for that evidence? And then we determine various ideas that might fit that data. And then we choose the best understanding of that data. And that is the minimal fact approach. See Behan McCullough, McCullough, in his book Justifying Historical Descriptions, gives us a number of criteria to work on in our historical investigation. Number one, the hypotheses together with other true statements must imply further statements describing present observable data. The hypotheses must have greater explanatory scope, that is, imply greater variety of observable data than rival hypotheses. Three, the hypotheses must have greater explanatory power, that is, make the observable data more probable than rival hypotheses. Four, the hypotheses must be more plausible, that is, be implied by a greater variety of accepted truths, and is negative implied by fewer accepted truths than rival hypotheses. Five, the hypotheses must be led ad hoc, that is, include fewer new suppositions about the past, not already implied by existing knowledge, than rival hypotheses. Six, the hypotheses must be disconfirmed by fewer accepted beliefs, that is, when conjoined with accepted truths, imply fewer false statements than rival hypotheses. And seven, the hypotheses must be must exceed its rivals in fulfilling conditions. Two to six, that there is little chance of a rival hypothesis after further investigation exceeding it in meeting these conditions. So, if your hypothesis explains a wide variety of data better than any other hypothesis, then yours is the most likely position to be true. And it has to be said that when we're dealing with historical knowledge, and historical knowledge is not the same as mathematical knowledge, that's important, because you get some apologists from the atheist and Christian side who will try and use the Bayes theorem, which is like a mathematical formula. But we can't have certainty in historical knowledge. We work on probability, trying to understand the best set of data for the best hypotheses. So in our historical inquiry, we're looking for whether our hypothesis has the facts for explanatory scope, explanatory power, plausibility, less ad hoc, compatibility with known beliefs, and that it can outstrip other rival explanations. Now, there are, in this hypothesis that Christ rose from the dead, we have 12 facts that are on the table before we even begin. And we'll look at those facts in a minute. Now, we can know whether Christianity is true or not, because it can be falsified. Christianity hangs on 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the idea that Christ rose from the dead. All we have to do to prove that Christianity is not true is to provide the evidence to show that Jesus didn't rise from the dead. So Christianity is falsifiable. If the Christian faith can be, if evidence can be given against it to prove that it still hasn't, Jesus hasn't risen, then that evidence can be provided. But if it's true, if Christ did rise from the dead, then evidence should be able to be provided to counteract those who would argue against it. But either way, it can either be proved or disproved. There is a criteria of falsifiability in the whole application. Now, in a debate with Anthony Flew, Gary Habermas stated as to the what most scholars would agree, and Anthony Flew, an atheist at the time, agreed with these 12 facts. Fact number one, Jesus died due to the rigors of crucifixion. Fact two, Jesus was buried. Now, I'll just unpack, he died to the rigors of crucifixion. Well, Tacitus and Josephus verify that he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. Jesus was buried, the Gospels link to that. His disciples, number three, doubted and despaired because Jesus' death challenged their hopes. And the Gospels and the Book of Acts point to that. Number four, the tomb in which Jesus had been buried was discovered to be empty just a few days later. Five, the disciples had real experiences that they believed were actual appearances of the risen Jesus. Six, the disciples were willing to die for the truth of these events. Seven, this gospel message was the very center for preaching the early church. Eight, the gospel was proclaimed in Jerusalem, a city where Jesus had died. Nine, the Christian church was firmly set forth by the disciples. Ten, the day of worship was Sunday. 11, James the skeptic became a follower of Jesus. And 12, Paul the persecutor became a follower of Jesus. Now there are a number of arguments against the resurrection, and the arguments against the resurrection, some of the arguments can go like these: the tomb was not known by the apostles, but that doesn't take into account the facts of 4 and 12. Maybe the woman came to the wrong tomb doesn't take into consideration facts 5 and 12. Some may say it was a legend, but this doesn't take into consideration all the facts from 1 to 12. And just an aside there, I've checked the history of Mithraism from 500 BC to 600 AD, and it's interesting to note there's very little documentation about these religious beliefs that skeptics say was part of forming Christianity. Now, Jesus could have had a twin, but that would not match with facts 4 and 11. What about people hallucinating? How does that account for facts 5, 11, and 12? You have a variety of experiences. You have individual appearances of Jesus to people and mass appearances, a variety of phenomena that's not normally associated with hallucination. And also, if it was an hallucination, then what is interesting there is it wouldn't that idea would not accord with the Jewish concepts of resurrection. They knew the difference between a ghost and an illusion and a physical resurrection. The idea that Jesus was a spiritual resurrection, it wasn't literally physical, doesn't match facts 4, 5, 11, 12, and is based on bad Greek semantics. Some might say that the resurrection body was stolen. This doesn't explain fact. Some might say that the body was stolen, hit by the authorities, but this doesn't explain facts 5 and 12. The idea that Jesus just died a little bit, kind of like fainted, but this discount doesn't fit with the facts 1 and 6. Some might say there was a plot. And this was all a conspiracy. Doesn't explain facts 5, 6, 11, and 12. One idea where all the facts fit is Jesus was an alien. You could have that as a repertoire. If you read Gary Habermas and J.P. Moreland, page 127, 128, Beyond Death, basically the resurrection is based on the disciples, their experience. This experience is based on eyewitness material. This eyewitness material is difficult to explain away on naturalistic assumptions. These various experiences of eyewitness material were reported earlier, making a very strong claim that there was historical continuity, that in the story that it wasn't just like made up and developed and rehashed by various editors and various groups, but there was already early at the beginning of Christianity a consistent story of the resurrection of Christ. Also, these people's lives changed. There was a notable difference in their behavior. James, who the Lord's brother, was converted and became a martyr thrown from the top of the temple. You know, he was a man who gave his life for the gospel. The facts that we have support the empty tomb. You can't deny that the resurrection was at the heart of the early church teaching. It was the main teaching, central teaching. If it was central and it was the main claim, they would have thoroughly made sure what they were saying was correct. And what is most devastating in all against all the critics is that this clear teaching that they had about Christianity, they preached it about his resurrection in Jerusalem. That would be the last place you would preach it. Interesting to note, the enemies of Jesus, such as the Jewish hierarchy of the time, were not able to present any evidence to overturn the resurrection. The fact that we see the church, how did Judaism develop into the church? What was the mechanism for that happening? That itself needs an explanation that the skeptics failed to give. Then the church changing from worship of Saturday on to a Sunday. How did this happen? Something shattering and momentous must have happened for Jews to do this. We see also that important things such as James, the brother of Jesus, a skeptic, became a Christian, followed Jesus. Paul, a blasphemer, became a Christian and trusted Jesus. As we look at these various evidences, we see that skeptical ideas do not explain the data. So the historicity or the historical veracity of the resurrection of Christ. And it's interesting to note that many scholars recognize the power of the minimal fact approach. William Wand, Oxford University church historian, says all the strictly historical evidence we have is in favor of it, and those scholars who reject it ought to recognize that they do so on some other grounds than that of scientific history. Now, one of the more powerful objections to the resurrection is Hume's contention. And that contention is very simple. He would say that basically, miracles don't happen because nature just doesn't do that. We see a uniformity in the nature, and we just don't see miracles happening. But David Hume developed a criteria to investigate miracles. There was a miracle claims during the French Catholics in the time of Pascal. And these miracle claims Hume decided to go and look back in history and investigate them. He had a set of about five or six criteria, and when he used the criteria on these miracles, he said that he had to admit that they'd taken place. And then he realized that, well, he had a more scientific explanation of miracles. So even though the historical evidence shows that miracles took place at the time of Pascal, and David Hume recognizing the power of this argument, then goes and denies it on the grounds not of evidence but on the nature of science and contingency. I think that if you go to the quantum level in physics, you will find that things are much more complex and nuanced than we really thought. And so therefore to be dogmatic and say miracles have not happened when something at the quantum level could come into as this existence or work with nature to change a situation is a possibility. It should be an open possibility to study the interjection of our way of thinking. So Hume is pretty easy to debunk by using Hume, really. So he denies miracles not based on evidence, but based on a presupposition. So that's the minimal fact approach to the resurrection. And I'll be doing another video on another subject in a second. Thank you for listening, and God bless. Hi folks, this is Jason, and hope you're okay today. We're going to just be giving some reflections on the resurrection of Christ, and trying to talk about whether there is any evidence for the resurrection. So first of all, from the Rational Response Squad, we read these words: there's actually no historical evidence that isn't hotly disputed item within the field of history to prove that he ever was even a man, much less the Son of God. So what are my thoughts about that? Well, I think that statement really shows really a lack of understanding of history about Christ. There are facts about Christ, which we're going to be looking at later, that show that he died, that there was an empty tomb, etc., etc. And these facts are not in dispute. They're accepted by the main body of scholars. So skeptics these days are propounding to you a bunch of lies. In 1 Corinthians 15, 14 and 15 we read, if Christ was not raised, then your faith is useless. If Christ was not raised, we are false witnesses. As we look at the resurrection of Christ, we need to ask certain questions. Can we find a variety of sources? Is there testimony from enemies? Is there anything that at Aristotle inquiry that adheres to the criteria of embarrassment? Is there any eyewitness material? Is this material early? These are some of the questions that we need to ask in this discussion about the resurrection of Christ. Dr. Gary Habermas has compiled a vast amount of sources. I think it's over 14,000 articles that he's looked at, and that he shows that adhere to certain basic facts. These articles are from Germany, France, etc., and he's compiled a massive encyclopedia of information about Jesus from these articles. That's majority of them believe in certain facts about Jesus Christ. So if we put these facts together, we get some amazing, interesting conclusions. If we looked at fact number one, recorded in all the Gospels and in sources that are not Christian, the fact that Christ died on the cross, that he died. You have Josephus, you have Tacitus, Lucian of Samosata, you have Mara Bara Serapion, and you have the Jewish Talmud. If that's not enough, I don't know what is. In the Jewish Talmud, it says Jesus was hanged. Hanging is a synonym of crucifixion. Tacitus and Josephus are accepted faithful, honest historians. The scholarship for Josephus, which I've noted many times to you, most will accept most of what Josephus says as accurate concerning Jesus. Maybe a few words have been interpolated, but most will accept that there is wide historical support that Christ died, crucified. Wasn't it not? Onfray, the French philosopher, who said no one was crucified in first century Jerusalem, and we found a first century skeleton with a crucifixion nail through the foot, thereby showing the atheist philosopher Onfray hadn't got a clue what he was talking about. John Dominic Crossan, Jesus, a Revolutionary Biography, page 145, said about Jesus and him dying on a cross that he was crucified is as sure as any historical anything historical can ever be. Next, one of the sources of evidence that the tomb became empty is enemy testimony. There is an unwitting testimony by the Sanhedrin that the tomb was empty. They said it had been stolen, but that's a tacit acknowledgement of enemy attestation. You can find in Justin Martyr's dialogue with Trypho, 108, Tertullian Speeches 30, Jewish Toledoth, he was not in his group. 11:15, you are not to say his disciples came during the night, and you are to say his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. So basically there is enemy attestation there. We can see that there were those who actually acknowledged that the body, the tomb, was empty. We also see that women were testifying to the empty tomb. Now, Jewish women particularly were not accepted as important in the law courts for testimony, so why would the early church use women to testify to the empty tomb? So we've understood that the empty tomb, and then fact number three, that there were appearances of Jesus. Now, you find in the Gospels that they really believed, the disciples really believed, that Jesus rose from the dead. 1 minute these disciples were timid at the crucifixion of Jesus. They were timid, and then afterwards they are bold. We have to explain this historical fact. Now, the main evidence for this is Peter, Paul, John, all stated that they had seen Jesus appear. We also have the 1 Corinthians passage, which is the earliest historical material we have about early Christianity and what they believed. We can look at various traditional writers, such as Polycarp, Irenaeus, also tells us that they believed in the early disciples saw resurrected Jesus. Now, there's a whole literature outside the Gospels that talk about the disciples seeing Jesus rise from the dead. We have the Didache, Clement of Rome, Shepherd of Hermas, Ignatius, Polycarp, Diognetus, Papias, Quadratus of Athens, Aristeas, Justin Martyr, Claudius, Apollinaris, Minicius, Felix, Melitor of Sardines, Hegesippus, Dionysius of Corinth, Irenaeus of Lyons, Rhodon, Theophilus of Caesarea, Theophilus of Antioch, Maximus of Jerusalem, Polycrates of Ephesus, Clement of Alexander, Tertullian, Serapion of Antioch, Apollonius, Caius, Philetus of Rome, and Origen. It kind of just goes on and on and on. Now, when the disciples saw these appearances, which we've been able to confirm by the Gospels and other literature and Paul's epistle, 1 Corinthians 15, it had an effect. These disciples became bold. They became contending for the faith in the very area that where they could have been disproved wrong. They were preaching in Jerusalem. So why? Why didn't anybody challenge them? So, Jim Jones and David Koresh says this: nearly all scholars agree that the disciples had the risen Jesus that transformed their life. So we have three grand facts on the table, which there's tons of evidence for. Jesus died, the tomb became empty. So that's Jesus died, the tomb became empty, number two and three. The disciples saw appearances of Jesus. We see also in this that Paul was converted, a murderer, a persecutor, a Pharisee. We also see that James was converted, the Lord's brother. Both were unbelievers, and yet they came to know and believe in Christ. So, these appearances were not only to the disciples, but to skeptics. So, again, we ask the question, which view, which opinion takes into consideration all the facts? As we look at those various hypotheses, we see that they all fell to the ground. I think if you read Norman Geisler, Frank Turek, I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist, Crossway Books, Wheaton, Page 299, we read Gary Habermas. Skeptics must provide more than alternative theories to the resurrection. They must provide first century evidence for those theories. And again, a number of theories that have come forward to try and compete is, number one, you have the idea that the Bayes theorem, that use the Bayes theorem like Richard Carrier, and if we use that method we can get to a better understanding of the resurrection. But the Bayes theorem nobody uses in historical inquiry these days, or if they do, they're very rare. You have people like Richard Carrier also saying that Jesus was a myth. This cannot be substantiated because the Gospels are just full and bursting full of historical facts. And it's obvious that to say that Jesus is a myth is just too simplistic and doesn't accord with the evidence. Also that one of the reasons for this myth idea is that Jesus comes from Mithraism. But if you look at Mithraism from 500 AD, BC to 600 AD, there's hardly any literature that tells you what Mithraism is. So when people are saying that Christianity came out of Mithraism, it's very weak scholarship at best. It's not even on the table, really, to be taken seriously. And in fact, no academic scholars in the historical Jesus studies takes those kind of ideas seriously. Dominic Crossan has come up with the idea that Jesus was a kind of Cynic philosopher in Galilee because we find Roman and Greek ruins. But if you read the first essay by Dr. Evans in the historical Jesus studies book, Cambridge Guide to Jesus, you'll find that he completely debunks Dominic Crossan by showing that the funerary rites and the pots that we found all confirm that Galilee was a very strong Jewish area. So, and there is no literature that we found of any significance that would prove that there was Cynic philosophical influence in that area. So Dominic Crossan's ideas fall to the ground. Bart Ehrman would generally try to show there are contradictions within the methodology and the methodology of many. If you read the book Inerrancy in the Gospels, or Gospels and the Inerrancy by Poythress on John Frame's website — John Frame is a Christian philosopher — there you'll find a really good exposition of the various contradictions of the Gospels. But when one gospel says an angel appeared, or another gospel says two angels appear, then you have to be careful, because it's only the gospel showing different emphasis. And as we look at it in that perspective, there aren't any contradictions. The other issue is conspiracy theories, that maybe there was some kind of conspiracy. Maybe authorities stole it. Maybe Jesus stole it. Maybe his disciples stole the body. Well, either way, why would the disciples be preaching in Jerusalem Jesus rose from the dead if they stole the body? Doesn't make sense. Or even if the authorities stole the body. So it just doesn't make sense at all. Some people have said over the years that Jesus could have just fainted, that he kind of like nearly died, and it looked as if he was dead. But can you honestly believe that a half emaciated Jesus would turn up with oars in his hands, almost dead, trying to gasp for breath, and then tell his disciples that Peter's disciples would go into Jerusalem preaching a resurrection. Do you really think that's a plausible hypothesis? In the ancient world, if you were crucified, you generally died. It's very rare that you didn't die. So, looking at it from a medical point of view, there is clear evidence that he died in terms of the blood coming out of the stomach with the water. The idea that maybe Jesus had a twin brother is just not plausible. We have no evidence of that. That Jesus, that it all happened through an alien, is some of the crazy stuff people have said. It actually is that really a plausible explanation? Fact of the matter is, there isn't any hypothesis that is better than the explanation that the Christian faith has, that Christ rose from the dead. It rules out every other possibility. Again, the only strong argument that you could use is the argument that miracles don't happen, that David Hume used, but that is debunked from the because of the quantum level. We don't know what goes on at the quantum level. So to be dogmatic like that is just not being intellectually honest. So you're left with strong evidence that points to Jesus rising from the dead. And I would recommend going to Gary Habermas's website on the resurrection. I would recommend that you go to Mike Lacona's website on the resurrection. And I would recommend that you read Lee Strubble's The Case for Christ, and also, if you want to read more scholarly information, The Resurrection of Jesus by Mike Lacona. So I hope this has been a blessing to you and an encouragement to you and a help to you today. And so God bless you, and see you soon. Hi folks, this is Jay. Hope you're okay today. It's good to see you. We're looking at Gary Habermas's PhD and Minimal, a Fact Approach to the Resurrection. The PhD is a defense of the resurrection. We've just been looking at Hume's scholarship with a few thoughts from C.S. Lewis as well. We're going to listen to Gary Habermas talk about the Minimal, a Fact Approach, and then we'll move into some thoughts on his PhD, and then move into reflections on what we've read and heard.
Eyewitness data. You have to rhyme things for... I teach exclusively PhD students, and for PhD students, required books go by colors. So take out your orange book. You know, that's what we do in grad school. And then we talk about alliteration, because it's easier for grad students to remember things. We don't do this with undergrads, because they don't remember whether you do it or not. But with grad students, I say the two E's, okay? Early and eyewitness, just like the George Washington question. We want people who are there, and we want people who are in the right place. You say, well, eyewitnesses could be wrong. Yes, they are, but what are you going to do? Cite nine eyewitnesses because eyewitnesses could be mistaken? No, we still use eyewitnesses. And we want them to be people who are in the right time, right place, asking the right questions, and so on. And it's real helpful if they're enemies. It's real helpful if they change their view. It's real helpful if there's checks and balances, and so on. That's how we do history. All right. On my little timeline here, that's going to be creation down there. This is the cross. Scholars usually say 30 AD, but you'd be surprised how seldom they answer that question. Probably the second most popular date is 33. I'm just going to say ground zero, give or take. It's about 30 AD. Down there is 2011. Now, before I do minimal facts, let me give you a typical way that somebody, I'm going to have to be real sketchy, but when somebody says the New Testament's at least a historically trustworthy book, let me talk about how they're going to do that. If you say, well, how do I know the resurrection happened? On this timeline, I'm going to say, well, one very common on the reliability argument response is going to say, well, the book of Mark is written, and I'm going to use skeptical dates, okay, so you can see it's not that huge an issue. The book of Mark is written about 70 AD. We're only plus 40. You have to study ancient history to know how good plus 40 is. It's just, it's great. Great time period. Okay, using critics' dates, Matthew, about 10 years later, at plus 80. Luke, about 5 years later, to about plus 85. Acts, plus 85, plus 90, something like that. Everybody, conservatives and liberals, puts John at about 95 AD. So my point is that if the worst it gets is we're about plus 65 to John. Now, critics often deal with sort of a double standard when they deal with the New Testament. And they're going to say, yeah, 95 AD, Matthew, 50, Luke, 55. Isn't that getting a little bit late? Well, when they ask questions like that, I'm not trying to be mean, but either they haven't studied a lot of ancient history, or they're not familiar with sources, or they're just being overly critical of New Testament or whatever. Because if I said, all right, forget Jesus for right now, and let's say ground zero is the death of Alexander the Great. What are our best sources for Alexander the Great? What are the best sources? Well, there were several people who wrote during Alexander the Great's life. But we don't have any of those sources. We don't have any of them. They'd be very valuable. We don't have any of them. The sources we have for Alexander are, and I'd have to keep walking way out past this window, because the best sources for Alexander date 300 to 450 years after his death, about 330 BC. The two best sources are Arian and Plutarch, but they're also the latest sources. They're about plus 425 to 450 AD. That's a long time. You go, okay, fine, I get your point. Maybe Alexander's not the best example. We have better examples than that. Yes, we do. But I'm just using Alexander because he's such a prominent source. Well, how about somebody who's better data and closer to Jesus' time? Okay. How about Tiberius Caesar? He is the Caesar who's on the throne when Jesus dies just a few years after Jesus dies. We have four major sources for Tiberius, and a total of about 10 sources for Tiberius. We have more than 10 sources for Jesus, and you go, yeah, but that's those prejudiced New Testament sources. Okay, more about that in a second. Use the way critics use, we still have more than 10 sources for Jesus. Do you know we have a dozen and a half sources outside the New Testament for Jesus? A dozen and a half sources outside the New Testament that are within 100 to 150 years after Jesus, which is fair in the ancient world. And now when I say 100 to 150, you realize that John's a lot closer than this. But back to Tiberius. We have four sources for Tiberius. One is contemporary. Whoa, we don't have anything like that for Jesus. But as I'm going to argue tonight, we do. We have sources, so I'm going to spend the rest of my time explaining, that go all the way back to 30 AD for Jesus. Okay, so next best source. By the way, the earliest one for Tiberius, the historian who gives the contemporary data, he's the least useful. The least useful of the four sources. The best source for Tiberius is Tacitus. And Tacitus, if that's Tiberius down there, ground zero, Tacitus, we'd probably be two-thirds of the way up the pews here. Because Tacitus writes, sorry, that's the last guy. Tacitus is going to, if that's John, Tacitus is going to be out here. Tacitus writes about 120 AD. He's plus 80 after Tiberius. Suetonius, plus 85. And Dio Cassius, two-thirds of the way up or further. Dio Cassius is plus 180 from Tiberius. So, well, okay, I see where you're going, but I have the ultimate objection for you. Gospels record miracles of Jesus. That disqualifies them. Really? Well, Greco-Roman, we'd say in English, bios. It's not pronounced that way in Greek, but Greco-Roman bios. It's a genre of biography, Greco-Roman biography, the most reputable writing in the ancient world. We have, say, the father of history, so-called, Herodotus, all the way through such names as Thucydides and all the way up to Livy and Julius Caesar himself, and I already gave you some names, Pliny, but we also have Tacitus, Suetonius, Dio Cassius, and so on. These guys write bios, and almost every Greco-Roman source includes miracles, prophecies, portents. Livy, probably second only to Tacitus for his reputation as a Roman historian, Livy records the founding of Rome by Romulus and Remus, the boys who were raised by a wolf, hundreds of years before his earliest source. Well, that's obviously false. But we do doctoral dissertations on this material, and it's fair to use this material and start. You go, well, I don't trust any of it if there's miracles. Or if there's miracles in Greco-Roman sources, isn't that a rival to Christian miracles? So you've got to ask the question of which miracles are evidenced. And I'll just say this to be provocative, and then I'm going to have to move on to my minimal facts deal. Almost every skeptical scholar, not the fly-by-night guys that don't work in the field that just take shots at Christianity, but skeptical scholars, I don't care how liberal they are, how far the left, virtually everybody today believes that Jesus was a miracle worker. Now, they're going to differ on how supernatural these things were and everything else. That's another question. But it's almost unanimous today, among even Jesus seminar people, they'll call Jesus a miracle worker and an exorcist. In fact, two of the best books that are out on this subject are each almost 500 pages.
Sorry, nearly falling asleep there. So, that's Gary Habermas explaining more of his minimal fact approach. Basically, what he's going to say is you're looking at the dates of the spectrum of the text from the Gospels from 60 to 70, 80, maybe 90 AD, depending whether you're conservative or in the middle. But what he's going to say is the Paul's epistles, specifically 1 Corinthians 15, goes right back to 32 AD and gives you historical information about Jesus, and you can use that then to give a case for Jesus' resurrection. What we've just looked at in Gary Habermas's PhD is that uniformity of nature does not preclude the possibility of miracles. If it did, you would need to know all the miracle claims that have been made and have debunked them, and that's not been done. When you have a criteria for investigating miracles, as Hume did, it actually proved to him that miracles do take place, but he still didn't believe. Page 102, the human testimony favour of these occurrences is impressive, especially in view of the fact that it concerns claims of supernatural events. That's Habermas. Swinburne writes, Habermas is quoting Swinburne. No testimony is sufficient to establish a miracle unless the testimony be such a kind that its falsehood would be more miraculous than the facts which endeavours to establish. Is always rejecting the greater miracle. Sorry about that. No testimony is sufficient to establish a miracle unless the testimony be such a kind that its falsehood would be more miraculous. I think that's David Hume. I would disagree. I think that it's basically just you're looking at history and you're just using historical methods. And if the historical methods are pointed to the fact that an event took place that seems to be supernatural, then so be it. You don't have to have greater evidence to outweigh the uniformity of experience. You just have to have evidence. Simple as that. Habermas says, the fact is that we only know a small part of nature and cannot be sure that what we do know will continue to be the same in the future. In other words, this so-called uniformity of nature, that the way things are, we don't see any dead people rise, is only our small understanding of the natural world. He quotes C.S. Lewis, I think, "The whole idea of probability, as Hume understood it, depends on the principle of uniformity of nature. We observe many regularities in nature, but of course all the observations that men have made or will make whole cover only a minute fraction of the events that actually go on. Our observation would therefore be nonetheless useless. The whole idea of probability, as Hume understood it, depends on the principle of uniformity of nature. We observe many regularities in nature, but of course all the observations that men have made or will make only covers a minute fraction of the events that actually go on." Also, Harry Bamas notes that we can't prove the uniformity of nature, and that I think that that Hume actually agreed with that in his writings. Habermas notes that David Strauss was heavily influenced by David Hume. Schleiermacher was of the opinion that miracles suspend the laws of nature. Bruno Bauer strongly says that we could not have miracles come into nature. Ernest Rayner said that Jesus did not know the laws of nature. Adolf Harnack said they were ancient ways of thinking. Paul Tillich said miracles can't interfere with the laws of nature. So Habermas deals with lots of scholars in the past and in the present on this issue of uniformity of nature, which is significant. If we're saying Jesus rose from the dead, we have to challenge this idea that because nature doesn't show any miracles, they don't happen. It can be challenged philosophically.